trusting in you. There's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy unending, sure. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy unending, sure. And I will follow.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to West Valley Calvary Chapel. Are you ready to worship?
Amen.
I'd like to invite you to stand if you're able, and let's worship the Lord together.
Thank you.
My apologies.
Thank you.
cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb.
Take a moment and pray. Father, we just want to give you thanks this morning. We do praise you, Lord. Thank you for delivering us from the sting of death. Thank you for taking away the keys of death and hell. Thank you, Lord, for opening up the gates of salvation. This morning, Lord, we want to rejoice in that. Jesus, we want to rejoice in who you are. So open our eyes and our hearts to your word this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Okay. Well, you guys, I'm looking for someone. I don't see her. Uh-oh. Catch her, Roger, catch her. Okay, we have a, aha! We're going to sing happy birthday to my wife. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Cindy. Happy birthday to you. They pulled her out of the nursery for that, right? How old was he?
13.
Oh my gosh, he's a teenager. Hunter, teenager. Pretty scary, I'll tell you that. That means you're going to be driving pretty soon. Woo! I'll be in a rest home by then, maybe, I hope. Huh? You guys want to sing happy birthday to Hunter? Huh? Let's do it. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Hunter. Happy birthday to you. All right, now, before we begin our study, I have one more little thing that I want to do. This is a very, very special weekend wherein we remember those who have given their lives and their service for our country, years gone by and presently. And I want to take a moment and acknowledge any veterans in this room. Would you please stand? Come on, guys. Thank you, thank you. Thank you for your service. It's kind of cool during this weekend as you're out and about because you might see fellas that have their little veteran hat on. And I was actually at a Wendy's last Memorial Day, and there was about four of them sitting at a table, these old guys, World War II guys, right? And they had their hats on, they looked really cute. But you know what, I was compelled, I went up and told them, you know what, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you guys for your commitment, what you went through, so that I wouldn't have to go through it. We need ever not forget, right, those guys. And I'll tell you something, just that little thing really blessed them. They thought that was really pretty cool. So you might remember them as the next couple of days go by. Let's go ahead and open our book, our Bibles, to the book of Hebrews. Now, today as we begin chapter 2, we have already established a principle in our study, and that is that Jesus is superior to angels. That Jesus was the creator of all things. That Jesus is the sustainer of all things. He holds them together. Now, when we open up into chapter 2, the first word that we see there is very important. It's the word therefore. I want to teach you a little Bible rule for your own personal lives, maybe. It helps me a lot. Whenever you see the word therefore, ask yourself, why? What is it there for? Right? It's kind of a cute little thing, easy to remember. Therefore, and I stop and I say, well, why? What is it there for? Whenever you see that word in the text, what that wants you to do is it wants you to back up a little bit to the point that's already been made prior to these new words in chapter 2. Another way we could word it would be, because of these things, we could say that too, it would be the same way. They use the word therefore. Because of these things, we must give the more earnest heed to the things that we have heard, lest we drift away. So the use of these words in this particular passage are very, very important. Drifting away. You know, the writer wants us to pay attention to something here. And as we go down through this study this morning, we're going to find out how important it is for us that we would pay attention to these things, that we would give the more earnest heed that to these things that we have heard. And what things have we heard? Well, this is what we've heard in light of Jesus, his superiority. We've heard the words of Jesus. We've heard the exhortations. We've heard the invitations to unbelievers or doubters. And yet this letter specifically was written for believers, Jewish believers. Fortunately, we get to take part in it this morning because it's all the same Jesus. It's all the same gospel, isn't it? Today, that might not be a real popular comment, but you know what? Praise God. I'm glad that there are brothers and sisters in the Lord, and I'm glad that one day we will rule and reign with them on the earth. I think that's awesome. So to give more earnest heed, this goes beyond listening. It means hearing carefully. But not only hearing carefully, but doing what we hear. We could sit in here all day long and hear awesome things. But if we don't do anything with it, we're all wasting our time. Well, I don't know. Some might leave feeling really justified because of what they heard. But if we don't put it into practice, you see, it's a waste of time, is it not? Why bother? So we need to pay attention earnestly to these words that we are learning about Jesus, to give heed to them. There is an urgency in that word. This morning, I look at myself and I say, do you feel a sense of urgency in your life, in your relationship with God? Do you feel a sense that we need to act upon what we've heard? We need to move upon the truths that we have received? The more earnest heed, the necessity of what we're learning should make us feel urgent. It should make us feel motivated. It should not be, well, you know, 35, 40 years ago, late 60s, early 70s, you know, there was this big, giant Jesus movement that happened. And actually, that's where the roots of Calvary Chapel was birthed, through that movement. And during that time, there was a great pouring out of the Holy Spirit. And young men and women who were lost in drugs and antisocial, didn't fit in, Jesus was calling them. God was calling these people to serve him in a spectacular way. And literally, the Holy Spirit was being poured out, and we all felt a sense of urgency. We believed that Jesus could come at any moment, and we lived our lives like that. But you know what? Sadly to say, I don't see that very much today. I spoke with another pastor the other day at breakfast, and we were talking about that very thing, and he said, you know, the revival's gone. It's not here anymore. That's why people are kind of asleep at the wheel. They don't have a sense of urgency in their lives. And folks, I really think that this is really important for us to take in this morning, to think, to even evaluate our own selves concerning this. How do I feel about it? And the reason he says here that we should have urgency and take heed to these things, lest we drift away. Now, it doesn't say lest we backslide in one day, or, you know, this is a picture of drifting. It has two actual pictures to the word. The first one would be a drifting boat in mind without an anchor. And naturally, without even trying, the boat will drift away. So the lesson there would be, if I'm not anchored in Christ, then I'm going to be subject to any current that happens to come along or any wind that happens to blow. I'm going to be drifting. And without an anchor, I have no way of securing myself. I can't be secure in the truth about Jesus and his supremacy if I'm drifting. We can drift really into danger. You know that, don't you? We can drift into places and we're unaware of it, and all of a sudden we realize we are in danger. And we're in danger not because God turns his back, not because he forgot, not because he's mad. We're in danger because we did not take earnest heed to these things. We did not take it seriously enough. Unfortunately, sometimes jobs are more important than Jesus. There's a lot of things that we put before Jesus, and we justify it by saying, well, I've got to have the job. You know, I'm an alcoholic, but I'm working in a bar. Right? I got to have a job. Kind of unwise. Or even when people want to shun you or close your mouth when it comes to your beliefs in Jesus Christ in the workplace. There's companies that have rules that you cannot talk about Jesus at work. Can you believe that? That would be very hard to do, for me at least. I get to talk about him all the time at work. It's great. Another picture of drifting here would be the word to slip. And that speaks of a landslide that just naturally lets go, the slipping of the landscape. Or the slipping from an arrow in the quiver, and it slips out. That's another picture for this word here. Dodds uses this word and translates it for us. It's another word, and this is amazing that I'm going to say this, but it's actually a word that has to do with food slipping down into your throat and getting stuck. Some of you know where I'm coming from on that one, huh? Thank you, Jesus. Our sister had something stuck in her throat this morning, and she's been in the emergency room, and the Lord pushed it all the way down. And all of a sudden you said, I think it's down. I think it went down. There you go. So that's, you know what? Here we have a living example of slipping. Slip sliding. Point here is that when we begin to depart from the faith, more than not, it's not something that you wake up one morning and decide that you're not going to be a Christian anymore and you're going to hang it up. And this is something that begins to happen very, very subtly. And as it continues, even when we're unaware, perhaps, that it's happening, we can be drifting, we can be slipping. This is the reason for urgency. This is the reason that it's so important that we understand who Jesus is. When we get a grip on who he is, we will have a sense of urgency. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in a bit. You remember in the book of Acts, in chapter 16, Paul was in jail. And the Philippian jailer came to Paul, and Paul had an opportunity to walk out of the jail. They're worshiping in the middle of tribulation down there in this dark dungeon. And from what I understand, back in those times, a jailer actually had living quarters in the jail facility. So he was always there. And his family lived there with him too. So this particular jailer came in and he began to talk to Paul. And finally the jailer says, What do I have to do to be saved? What do I have to do to be saved? And of course, we know the answer to that. Believe on the name of Jesus Christ and you'll be saved. And then something else was added to this Philippian jailer, you and your household. We have to be careful again with Scripture, because that doesn't necessarily mean if you get born again that everyone in your family is going to get born again, right? We know that. That's the facts. In this specific case, though, it happened for this man. Paul could have answered him and said, instead of saying, what must I do, Paul could have said, do nothing. Do nothing. You don't have to do anything. That's enough. It's not enough. Because if you do nothing, if I do nothing, we're going to be drawn by the currents of the world. We're going to be drawn by the flesh. We're going to be drawn by the devil. And we're going to drift away. The Bible says in the last days that there will be a great falling away from the truth. We are living in that day today. Great compromises concerning who Jesus is and who God is and who you and I are. There's apostasy everywhere we turn. Heresy everywhere, bad doctrine, lies. People who have left the truth and drifted into other areas. And so this protection that we can have against drifting would be to say, hey, Jesus is my anchor. He keeps me from drifting. Jesus is the rudder of the ship. He keeps me going where I need to go. He keeps me on course. So important. In verse 2, it says, if the word spoken through angels proved steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just reward, then how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard him? Very interesting passage. The word spoken, you know what he's referring to here? This might be kind of a mind blower to you. He's referring to the law of Moses. He's referring to the Ten Commandments. He's referring to the law that Moses was given through angels from God. And you might think, oh, wait a minute, I've never heard that before. That God used angels to deliver the messages to, well, that's what we see here. And I want to give you one more passage, and there are many others that I can use to Deuteronomy 33:20 is one. Galatians 3:19 is one. I've chosen Acts chapter 7, and I want to read this to you, and it makes it very clear what I'm speaking of right now. In Acts chapter 7, starting in verse 52, it says, which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? See, Stephen's talking to the Jewish people right now. Which one of the prophets did you not persecute? None of them. They were all persecuted, weren't they? All of them. Which one of the prophets did you not persecute? Which one did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who foretold the coming of the just one. This is history. Of whom you now have become the betrayer and the murderers. Listen, who have received the law by the direction of angels and have not kept it. Angels played a very big role, didn't they? But yet we know that Jesus is superior to angels. The word came, was delivered by angels, and there's, of course, many other scriptures that we can read to see how that works. And very interesting little piece of scripture there to me. The word that was spoken through the prophets proved to be true when they said, hey, if you if you do a crime that has capital punishment, then you're going to get drug outside and stoned. If you're unfaithful, you're going to get drug out and stoned. If you're worshiping an idol, the penalties are very, very costly. And the people knew that, and they took it very, very seriously. There was no messing around with the law that God gave to men through angels. It was cut and dry. There's no wiggle room there. You blow it, you pay. And sometimes you pay with your own life. That word was steadfast. That's what it means. It was reliable. It was true. It did take place. Every transgression and every disobedience received a just reward. Now, if we take that seriously, the Ten Commandments, the law of God, we take that seriously and we live our lives in accordance with that out of fear of violating that and suffering the consequences, how much more seriously should we take the truth concerning Jesus? How can we neglect? Now remember who he's writing to here. He's writing to the Hebrew people. So he's telling them, you take the law of Moses so much, even to a fault, and you take it very seriously. But look at what Jesus has done, and look at who Jesus is. And if you neglect him, how can you neglect him if you truly understand who he truly is? You cannot. So how shall we escape? And really that's all about, that's very true. They wanted to escape, didn't they? They wanted to escape bondage. They wanted to escape legalism. They wanted to be free, just like we all do here today. We want to be free. We want to enjoy freedom in our lives. But he says, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? What's the answer to that? There is no escape. You know that this morning? There is no escape. There's only one way that you and I are going to avoid this specific judgment, and that is to give our lives to the Lord Jesus Christ. To bow our hearts and our lives and our mind before him and say, Lord, I've sinned against you. I can't do this on my own. I'm living in a crazy world. I don't know where to put my attentions on things. I don't know what the priorities should be in my life. I'm lost. And so is my family. And so is my marriage. So is my business. Lord, I need forgiveness. And I need Jesus in my life. You know that when we pray that prayer, that it's like the bat phone that goes right to the White House or something. The direct line right to the throne. We will escape one way only, and that is if we accept this great salvation. Then he comes back talking about Jesus and the salvation message. He says, which at first began to be spoken by the Lord himself. And it was confirmed by us, or by those who heard him. And then God also in verse 4, bearing witness both with signs and wonders and various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit to his own will. Now, when we did the introduction to this book, I shared with you that a lot of people believe that Paul was the writer of this book. And there's a lot of evidence for that. But this verse right here is evidence that he did not write the book. Because you'll see here that the writer of the book is telling us that he received this truth secondhand. Paul didn't receive it secondhand. He received it right from Jesus. The idea here is that the testimony of those who went before our writer here, our author, that testimony was true. It was reliable. It was a greater word than what God had given earlier. It was a more serious word. Not to neglect this great evangelistic move of God on our behalf. It is a great salvation. It is great. Sometimes I think that, we need to take the Word of God more seriously. And His message should be regarded as greater than any other message that we could receive. There should not be compromise in that area. The word neglect here is another interesting word in the text. We find the same word in Matthew chapter 22 when Jesus is giving the invitation to come to the marriage supper. And it says that a lot of people disregarded the invitation. So many disregarded the invitation that Jesus had to go out and find people to bring in. That word to disregard is the same word we have here for neglect. It's the very same word. And it applies, of course, to the danger here of neglecting salvation on the Jewish people's part. This book was never really written to be an evangelistic book. It's written to encourage Christians. It's written to encourage Jewish Christians and to help them to understand that after thousands of years of bondage and law and all of the trappings that went along with it, that's not what Jesus is all about. Those things pointed to Him, but they weren't Him. They were a shadow, but they were not the substance of it. He is the substance. You know, I can see a shadow of myself, and I can say, well, there's my shadow. That's not me. It's just a shadow of me. And it's the same thing with the prophets and the prophecies and everything that took place through the Old Testament. Those were a shadow of the authentic one who was Jesus. That's what we want to see in Hebrews, how they are being helped to see that. To see that their laws and their all of their things that they did, that was not what it was about. It was only something that pointed to what it was all about. So it is a great salvation. And listen to this. If we neglect it, you know what that means, really? You know what we're saying? It's not that great after all. Isn't that true? I mean, sometimes, you know, you just got to be honest. My actions speak a lot louder than my words, right? The things that I do speak a lot louder than the things that I say. And if I'm neglecting such a great salvation, then I'm not really considering it that great after all. Maybe I'm putting it in a place where of convenience for me in my life. Is it convenient today to be a Christian? Is it convenient to be a Christian today when there's so much going out there that I would rather be doing? And when I see that, I think, then you don't really understand the greatness of your salvation. There is nothing that should be able to come between Jesus and you. And when we begin to allow that to happen, we begin to drift away, and we begin to suffer the consequences for it. So, again, the words that were spoken by the Lord, the word that was proven to be steadfast, and the word that was spoken by Jesus Himself with signs and wonders and gifts of the Holy Spirit. And all of those who heard Him speak. And everything that was said was confirmed by Jesus Himself. Now, this is, like I said earlier, this is a reason that a lot of people believe that Paul was not the author of this letter. All of the other writings of Paul, clearly Paul puts himself on an equal level with all of the apostles and all of the other eyewitnesses of the things concerning Jesus. But this passage does not say that. It was second hand. It was handed down to this person. I'm not going to call it. I'm not going to make a judgment on it. Personally, I'd like to say, I think Paul wrote it. But this passage does give me cause to wonder, right? Kind of wonder. Does it matter? Who wrote the book, really? I mean, think about it. Didn't the Holy Spirit write the book? Doesn't matter if John or Peter or Paul or whoever penned it. The Holy Spirit authored it, and that's the most important thing. One of the things that Jesus did was he said that miraculous signs would follow those who believe. Have you seen any miraculous signs lately? I know you don't want to shake your head no, but you're probably thinking that. Where are the miraculous signs? Where are the wonders? Where are all those things that he said that we would experience in him? Is it possible? Is it possible that as the church at large drifts away, that we're handcuffing God, that we're causing the flow of the Holy Spirit to be interrupted? And it's affecting the body of Christ. See, I'm convinced and I know for sure today that God does miracles today. I know for sure today that God heals people still. I know that for sure he wants to fill you with his Holy Spirit. He wants you to have power. He doesn't want you to be spineless jellyfish bobbing around with the current. He wants you to have power. He wants you to be strong. And the strength that comes from him is a strength that comes from nowhere else. And here's the danger in this whole thing. Yeah, maybe things are being quenched in today's church. Perhaps. But you know what? I got to tell you something. I see miracles all the time in this body right here. I see miracles in my life. And you might think, well, what kind of miracles? I could tell you a miracle right now. You might go through life and say, well, that really wasn't a miracle, was it? Well, how about a person who feels the Lord saying, I want you to pack up and I want you to go to Oregon. Yeah, but Lord, what am I going to do when I get there? Where am I going to stay? Don't worry about it. I'll take care of you. You just get to Oregon. Okay. All right. I'll go to Oregon. And so for a little bit of time, you're kind of floundering around and you're thinking, well, where am I going to stay? What doors are going to open up? I'm kind of starting to fret. I don't know what I'm going to do. And then all of a sudden, God moves. All of a sudden, he shows you a place that he wants to give to you. And you know what? That place is within walking distance of all the places that you need to be. It's the perfect place. Right? Now, how did that happen? Oh, I don't know. It was just chance. Huh? It was just chance. Maybe that guy had good luck. Well, I know that guy, and I wouldn't say that he has good luck. I would say that he has Jesus. And that's the reason it happened. And in my eyes, that's a miracle. A miracle is basically when God moves and does things that we really can't wrap our brains around. How did he do that? It's a miracle. It's a mystery. A mystery is just something that we really don't understand yet, right? A miracle is something that we don't understand how it works, but it does. And when people exercise faith, when they use their... See, you may have... Remember what Jesus said to them? He said, oh, ye of little faith. You know, where is our faith? Is it little? You know, you might say, no, my faith is strong. I would encourage you this morning, examine yourselves. The Lord's telling me today, Tom, examine yourself to see whether you be in the faith, to see whether you're growing and learning and becoming stronger, or are you drifting and compromising and letting go? We might let go of him. He's not going to let go of us. He He's always faithful no matter what. But all of these signs that Jesus said would follow them, all of those gifts of the Spirit that were functioning in the time of the writing of the New Testament are still available to us today. And I'm talking about prophecy. I'm talking about encouragement. I'm talking about all the word of knowledge, discernment, teaching, comfort, hospitality. That's a gift of the Spirit. There are just people that just love to have people over. And every time you go, it's a good experience. And there's also a gift called the gift of helps. Not a whole lot of people want to get that one. The gift of helps is basically, what can I do to help? Anything. I don't care what it is. Just point me in the right direction and I'll do it. These gifts are operating today and they are still miraculous gifts. But if you and I want to enjoy that, if you and I want to experience that in our lives, then we need to do what the Bible's asking us to do and not drift. Do the opposite of drift. Be a Klingon. Klingon. Yeah. In John, he says, I'm the true vine. We were talking about that yesterday at men's breakfast. I'm divine and you are de branches. And I thought to myself as we were reading that, you know, that's really awesome and beautiful, and we've read it a billion times, but what does a vine need to really prosper? It needs something to cling to, doesn't it? It might be a trellis, it might be a pole, it might be a tree. You've seen these trees with ivy almost all the way. Without that tree, there'd just be stuff being trampled on all over the ground. A vine has to have something to cling to. And you and I are the branches of that vine that need to cling to Jesus. To the things that we know to be true. And it's not designed in verse 3 to threaten us. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? It's just a matter of fact. There is no escape. You know that this morning, don't you? There's no escape from that very truth. There's only one way, and Jesus laid it out for us. I'm glad there's only one way, aren't you? I mean, wouldn't it be a bummer if there were 10 ways? We'd all be fighting about which way you should go and who's doing this and who's doing that. There's one way to heaven. And that is through Jesus. It's hard to say what is worse, the denial of miracles and of the gifts of the Spirit or counterfeiting them. Did you know that can happen? Did you know the gifts of the Spirit can be counterfeited? In other words, they're phony baloney. They're not authentic. And the sad thing is today, since the church has been drifting away from clinging, and people are wanting to see signs and wonders, this is also a prophecy of end times, that people are going to want to see signs and wonders to prove that God's involved in it. That doesn't mean God's involved in it. Pharaoh's guys did all kinds of signs and wonders, didn't they? They certainly weren't on God's side. They were counterfeiters. By human effort, we cannot conjure up spiritual gifts. We can't conjure up the things that God wants to give into our spirits. We have to be open vessels and say, Lord, fill me. You have not because you ask not. And because we ask not is because we're afraid. I'm afraid of what's going to happen to me. I might stand up in the middle of church and lose control and start flopping all over the floor and howling like a dog or something. I can promise you right now that will never ever happen if it's true Holy Spirit gifting. That's counterfeit. That's an effort to take your attention off of the main thing and to watch that fellow flop. Wow, look at that dude. He's really filled with the Spirit. Drooling and flopping and laughing, and sweating. Some people are drawn to that, but it's phony. We need to have the real thing going on in our lives, and it's there. It's available. It's easy for us to have. All we need to do is cling and not drift. All we need to do is take salvation very, very seriously. For in verse 5, he has not put the world to come, of which we speak, in subjection to angels. Again, we're comparing angels. But he testifies in a certain place, saying, what is man that you are mindful of him? Or the son of man that you would take care of him? You have made him a little lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor. You have set him over the works of your hands. And you have put all things in subjection under his feet. You know what he's talking about there? He's talking about us. That's who he's talking about. He's talking about humanity. And because God made everything in subjection under our feet, when Jesus comes on the scene, he needs everything to be in subjection under his feet, and he follows the same outline that God drew up for everybody else. He becomes human. He is not half God and half man. He's not man on the outside and God on the inside. He is all God and he is all man. He is divinity that took upon itself flesh. The nature of flesh he took upon himself. He became human. That's powerful, is it not? What is man? Well, I always wonder that myself. You ever look up in the skies and say, wow, Lord, who am I that you would have any care for me at all? I'm like a flea on the butt of a buffalo here. Really insignificant. Right? A grain of sand on the beach or whatever. No, we're not. Look what he's done for us. And we blew it in the garden. It didn't take long for us to blow it, did it? But we blew it in the garden. We haven't really experienced these things here that he has in this passage for us. But Jesus did. Jesus did accomplish this passage. Jesus did fulfill this word. Almost. There's yet a little things to be done. One of them would be to put everything under his foot. Everything evil, everything contrary to God, for him to snuff it out. And believe me, that time's coming very soon. That will completely fulfill who he is. The world to come in subjection to angels? No. He never gave angels that dominion. Man had that dominion, but man blew it. Angels do not have dominion over the earth or over the world to come. The divine purpose for the world is that man would rule over the world or the world to come. Jesus became a man. The divine purpose, not angels to rule, Griffith Thomas wrote, not for angels, but for man. What is man? What is man? Again, reminds me of the smallness of we are compared to all the other things. He made us a little lower than the angels. He made us to have choice. He made us to have the ability to become like him. Not that we're going to be God, but to become like him. Forever, for all eternity. You know, the angels will never have that privilege. Never. They will never have the privilege of having a body. You know, the Bible says that the angels are very curious about you. They're very curious about the things of the gospel, that they look into those things with intent eyes. They're curious. They're all around you, believe it or not. I hope you do believe it. So the second part of verse 8 says, "For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we do not yet see all the things put under him. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone." Everyone. Might taste death for all of us. That's an amazing thing to me. All of the people throughout history is being referred to here. Not just us. All people. This passage doesn't say, I want to finish with this. This passage does not say that you can see him. It doesn't say that you have seen him. It doesn't say that we will. It says that we see Jesus now. Now, in the present time of our lives. We see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels. He is our Savior. He is the one who suffered death. And by suffering death, he was crowned with glory and honor because he tasted death for all of us. This morning, as we wrap up, I want you to know that we can go ahead and bring the worship team up if you want to come on up. Approaching the scripture and the things of God through this particular book gives us a really in-depth view of things. I'm really blessed. I have waited so long to go through this with you. I'm so excited to be able to do it. But I want to just leave you with this. If it's not great, then you won't pay much attention to it if it's not great in your life. So when you go today, ask yourself that question. How great is it in my life? Is it great enough that everything else comes second? Or is it great enough that I'll do it when it's convenient? Good question to ask, isn't it? For all of us. The Bible says that we should do that, you guys. It says that we should be asking ourselves these questions. We should be judging ourselves. You know, it's not your neighbor's job to do that. It's not your wife's job to do that. It's not your husband's job to do that. The Bible says, judge yourselves so that you won't be judged. Keep an eye on yourself because you know what? You can drift. Father, we just pray this morning that you would help us, Lord. We cry out to you. We ask you, Lord, help us not to drift. Lord, give us the impact of what you did for us. Give us the eye of faith, Lord, much better than our natural eye. We want to see Jesus through the eye of faith. We want to see him as he truly is. And we want all that you have for us. Help us, Lord, to navigate that. Help us, Lord, to reach out when we need to. Help us, Lord, to continually monitor our own lives. I just pray, God, that you would bless each person in this room this morning as we prepare to do our last couple of songs. And, Lord, those that might need prayer, Lord, that you would just touch their hearts. Encourage them, Lord, to get up and take those steps over to the prayer room this morning that they might get prayed over. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Let us continue worshiping.
Thank you.
for us this morning. Lord, we just pray that everyone goes out of here today receiving a blessing from you. Bless the rest of this day, Lord. We thank you for our veterans. Let us not forget them. Lord, we pray this through your Son's name and our King, Christ Jesus. Amen. You are dismissed.